Do you wanna dance and hold my hand? Tell me, baby, I'm your loving man. Oh, baby, do you wanna dance?
Our star of the show, Sophia Constantinovna. How did I do, Sophia?
You did really well.
Did I get that name?
Oh, yeah.
I love calling you Sophia and Sapphire, because that's how I originally met you, Sophia and Sapphire. That's your company name, is that right?
Yes, it's my business name.
Okay, that's awesome. And, you know, the theme of the show, Do You Want to Dance? And the biggest thing that we're going to be talking about is, do you want to dance? Do you want to just rock it when you are first husband and wife out on the dance floor for that first ever dance as husband and wife, and you want to just rock it in front of your friends, in front of your family, with all the photographers there, the videos going there, and you are just totally freaking out, but you can make that freakiness go away, right?
Yeah, well, it's actually just making it natural and learning to dance for the rest of your life together.
Oh, that's right. But I mean, that first dance is just, I mean, that is so important in terms of memories, because the wedding day itself, there's so many memories of the wedding day. I mean, picking out the dress, and then your bridesmaids, and all the wedding party pictures, all those things, is just huge. And that first dance is right up there amongst the most important things that you're going to do on your wedding day.
Well, yeah, you have to be in front of everyone.
That's right.
Show them what you got,
you're
right? You're going
to be doing something that maybe you're not naturally inclined to do. Maybe.
And it's going to be forever in history in those
photographs. That's right. So you want to feel comfortable about that. Now, you do so many other things. We're going to talk about many of the other things that you do. But Do You Want to Dance? The focus of this radio show is primarily that first dance for husband and wife. I mean, there's so many other aspects of dance. In fact, once the husband and wife have done their first dance and they've spent that night dancing with all of their guests at the wedding reception, that's a skill that they can keep with them for the rest of their lives.
That's right.
I mean, date night, they can go out on the town and go dancing, and then there's competitions and exhibitions, and you know, when you're married, you're going to go to other people's weddings. You're going to dance
exactly
at their reception.
Right.
So this is a skill that will transcend that wedding night, but that's really the focus. And we're going to be talking about all the other types of dances and other opportunities that people have to dance, and we will get to that over the course of the show. But I wanted to make certain that our listeners out there understand the concept and the driving force behind this show, and that really is the first dance as husband and wife. Now, since our roles are kind of reversed today, normally you're going to be doing the interviewing, but today you're in the hot seat, so I get to ask you the questions. So let's ask you the most obvious question. Have you ever had that first dance as husband and wife?
Actually, no, not that kind of first dance. I've had many first dances in terms of different types of first dances.
Okay, as an example?
Well, you know, exhibition is one, obviously.
Right.
My first competition, you know, my first many of different types of dances. I haven't been married, so I haven't had the first dance.
Haven't had that first dance.
Yeah, haven't had that one.
Okay, yeah, no, who knows? Maybe sometime in the future. We're not going to go there, but let's just say that that option is always open to you, isn't it?
Yeah, and you know what? The thing is, whenever you do something for the first time, it just seems really untouchable, like as if it's so scary that you can't do it because you don't even have experience doing it.
Yeah,
you know?
Don't have any muscle memory. You don't have any any history with it. So doing anything for the first time is always kind of scary.
It's really scary. So, you know, everyone needs a little jump start or a segue into making something untouchable tangible. And that's where I come in. I kind of make it easy. Instead of making it daunting and scary and too show-offy, you know, make it make sense in people's lives.
Oh, absolutely. It makes total sense to me. So let's talk a little bit about your company name, Sophia in Sapphire. Where did that name come from? I mean, obviously your name is Sophia, but where did the in Sapphire part come from?
Well, you know, the thing is, when you're on the dance floor, you enter this totally other world where you don't feel like that anywhere else in your life. And you know, when you experience the benefits of dance, you just sparkle on the dance floor. You experience these endorphins, these feelings, you know, happiness, connecting with someone else. It's like sparkling on the dance floor.
Sure.
You know, and it's kind of hard to say in words. What I just described is very wordy, but you know, a gem in
yes.
itself is pretty brilliant.
And is that the color you're wearing today? Is it sapphire? Is that
yeah.
your color?
it's a hue.
Yeah, it looks delightful.
Thank
looks
you.
Delightful.
Thank you, Al.
So you mentioned earlier the fact that you have had many first dances in terms of, you mentioned competition.
That's right.
So you are a competitive dancer, is that right?
Yes, I'm a competitive ballroom dancer.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Okay, so what that means is I go out there on the comp floor, and what you see on TV, I mean, this is me doing it in real life. It's not like a show or anything. This is putting my dance skills to the test.
Wow, that's got to be daunting. I mean, I can't
yeah.
even imagine that.
It is scary, you know, because however you do is gets marked, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. You got the, judges, you got people watching.
Yeah,
you
and so
from all angles.
If you do mistakes, I mean, people know. I mean,
oh,
this
yeah.
is your reputation.
That's right. I mean, many of us watch, you know, every week on the big screen or on television, big screen in my house anyow. Dancing with the Stars, and you
That's
see
right.
those judges. I mean, they go, you know, back there in bar number 32, when you kicked your leg up, I don't think you kicked up quite high enough, so I'm going to
uh-huh.
deduct some points. I mean, they get really picky on those things.
I know, but the cool thing is that the real world is not about competition.
Exactly. The real world is all about getting out on the dance floor and enjoying yourself, connecting with your partner, enjoying all of the other benefits that go along
yeah.
with dance.
And the thing is, people watch shows like that and they're like, you know, dancing's not for me. I have 2 left feet. You know, I just like to watch a show. But the reality is, that's not what dancing
is. Well, the reality is, maybe competitive dancing isn't
yeah.
for them, but dancing for enjoyment is a complete, you know, another world, isn't it?
Yeah, so that's where I come in and I address, you know, the needs of beginners. Like, what does it take to get out there? That's the scary part, the first move. What do you do?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I want to know, because it has been, okay, I'll admit it, I'm in my mid-50s, and it has been a long time since I have been on the dance floor. So I would probably qualify as a newbie, okay, given
uh-huh.
the fact that it's been 25-ish years
mm-hmm.
since I've been on the dance floor. So let's say I'm a beginner. Where would I start?
Well, that's a toughie, right? If none of your friends dance, what do you do?
Yeah, exactly. So what do I do?
Well, you know what? The best thing to do is find some people that share that interest. And for example, what I do is I have a meetup every Monday.
Oh, okay.
And I invite, you know, whoever I meet, because people say they're kind of interested, but they're like, but they say no because they don't know how to start. So I say, hey, just come, check it out. We just do basics. Every month is a different dance, and just learn some basics under your belt and meet new people. I'll introduce you to some partners,
all
and
right.
people get excited, right?
Yeah.
So people need a facilitator
yeah.
or, you know, that person to take them by the hand and be like, it's not so scary. And they get to dance with me at the meetup.
Awesome.
You know?
Awesome. Because, okay, I want to come clean here. I said that I hadn't been on the dance floor in like 25 years or so, but the truth is about 8 or 9 years ago when I met my current wife, we went out on a, let's call it a double date to a hotel casino to see a comedy show. And afterwards, there was a dance going on in one of the lounges at this particular casino. And I thought, okay, you know, one of our first dates, I mean, maybe the third or the fourth date, we've been out a couple of times. And I said, okay, let's go, we're going to go dance. And she said, no, we're not.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, yes, we are. And she says, no, we're not. So I had to literally just drag her out on the dance floor.
Mm-hmm.
And we did dance, and it was enjoyable.
Mm-hmm.
But since that time, we just have never gotten back out on the dance floor. And I feel so bad because when I was younger, I really, really did enjoy it.
Yeah, you know, well, it does take some practice, I have to say. You know, it is muscle memory, like you've mentioned before. You need to do the repetition. And the best way to get better at it is to keep doing it.
That's right. In fact, the word that my wife uses, she's an elementary school teacher, she says schema is what you need to have. And that's basic understanding or, you know, muscle memory, if you will, for any particular activity. And if you've got schema, if you've got that muscle memory, it's a whole lot easier, but you got to start someplace.
Well, and the cool thing is, once you develop this muscle memory, there are benefits that come with it.
Oh,
right?
Really? What are you saying?
Well, the benefits of dance, Al.
Okay. But, I mean, let's be honest. The benefits of dance, I mean, it does give you an opportunity to connect or reconnect with your partner. Because, let's face it, after a while in a relationship, you know, sometimes you just don't stay as connected as you once were. And dance, to me, seems like the great opportunity to reconnect with your partner and maintain that sense of connectivity.
Well, just like what dance chemistry is all about, right?
I didn't know that term, but that, you know, that makes a lot of sense. Dance chemistry.
Dance chemistry. And it's a remedy for relationships. I've seen it happen before.
Really?
Yeah, you know, because it's body language. You can show that you care for a person through actions.
Yeah, I
And
suppose.
Sometimes the words get in the way.
Yeah. I mean, I don't have anything in the way of my relationship. I have a very good relationship with my wife. Things are totally good, top to bottom, inside and out. But, you know, since I've known you and have been talking to you about dance, it's really starting to pique my interest a little bit more for getting back out there. And it's another activity that I can share. Now, my wife is very involved in teaching, spends a lot of time, effort, and energy. And then I have my separate interests, and a lot of times we don't have time to connect. But if we were to make a date to go to dance lessons or to go out dancing one particular night of the week or two, then that would be an opportunity for us to, you know, maintain that good relationship that we have.
Or give it a spark.
Absolutely.
But, you know, it is a hobby that you share, and a lot of times we get so busy, we start doing our own hobbies, and we don't include each other in our lives.
Yeah, exactly. But when you have a spouse, a significant other, and you have learned to dance with them, then, there's just one more sense, one more connection point, I suppose.
Yeah, it's true.
Wow. So I'm going to have to be there next Monday night, aren't I?
I really do hope you make it, Al.
Well, I do have some Monday evening commitments, but, you know, I will come out to another night, or I will definitely get there.
Okay, Al.
We'll definitely get there. So we just have about another minute and a half or so before our first break, but I wanted to get down to your mission. Why in the world? I mean, I understand that dance is important to you. Why in the world have you taken it to this level to get out there and teach others how to take advantage of all the benefits that dance offers? Where does that motivation come from?
Well, we'll talk more about this, but just briefly, it's me giving back. You know, it's not only my passion, but I've seen so many people's lives change and transform through dance. It's just a natural remedy for a lot of us, because we live in a tech-driven world, and we just become so disconnected from reality, from important people in our lives. And dance has been one of those things that reconnects us.
It certainly does. You know, there's no doubt about that. Now, when we come back from our break, we're going to talk a little bit about some of your history. I know that you have spent some time in the Peace Corps, and that is an exciting story. And we want to find out some of the benefits, how dancing can change lives and influence lives and benefit lives. And we'll talk more about your meetup group, and then also a little bit about some of the music that drives and motivates and inspires the various dances. Does that sound good?
Yes, nice.
All right, let's go to our first break. We will be back after these words from our commercial messages. You're listening to Do You Want to Dance on Vegas All Net Radio. Guest today, Sophia. It is just a delight and an honor to have you sitting in that guest chair and telling us your story.
Oh, well, thanks for being here, Al.
I wouldn't have missed it for the world. So thanks for letting me do this.
Thank you so much.
Now, you've been on some of the other radio shows that I do here at Lotus Broadcasting, the Sex and Money Show, KLAV, 1230 AM. And that's where we originally, well, actually we met one time before that, but you've been on the Sex and Money Show talking about your dance a number of times. So we've known each other for a while now, and one of the terms that I've heard you use in the past is the tragedy of technology. Would you please explain to our listeners what you mean when you use that phrase, the tragedy of technology?
Yeah, well, it consumes us. It takes us away from experiencing reality, experiencing natural highs in life, connecting with other human beings. It's a very encourages a solitary lifestyle. You know.
Wow, you know, you are absolutely right. How many times have we gone out to a restaurant and seen a family of two or three or four, however, and everybody is sitting there with their thumbs going 100 miles an hour, they're texting, or they're on Facebook, or they're Twittering, or they're taking a picture and posting it to Instagram, or who knows, but it is kind of sad, because, you know, technology does get in the way of, you know, human relationships. I never thought of it that way, but now that you mention it, I see it all the time.
Well, and I had the unique experience of working at a dance studio, and teaching dance across from Google.
Did you really?
In Silicon, Bay Area?
Silicon Valley.
Silicon Valley. Yeah, and almost all my students are, you know,
Googlers.
From,
huh?
Yeah, Googleites, or from the Silicon Valley. And I was able to observe a lot. You know, anywhere from even not being able to socially integrate. Or even though have social lifestyles, lack of exercise, or, you know, that awkwardness, because...
So they, what you're saying is they really are techno nerds.
Well, this is the identity
they don't have
a techno nerd.
They don't have a life outside of that keyboard and that screen.
Yeah, but you know, and it's not only them. I mean, you don't have to be a tech nerd to experience... the calamity of technology.
True. So, you know, something just dawned on me. One of your taglines is go from nerdy to flirty.
Right.
And that is where this was inspired
from.
Well,
that's what it is, because we're so out of touch. You know, it's not natural for us to come up to someone and snag them for a dance or be confident enough to be able to... you know, speak to someone or dance with someone or put yourself out there just to have fun, to be goofy, to have an outlet of some sort.
Because let's face it, you are taking a risk. I mean, number one, when you ask someone to dance, you're taking a risk that you might be turned down.
It might be
rejected. And then, if you get out on the dance floor, you think that you're going to look like Elaine Benes from
I actually saw that
clip. Was that hilarious?
That was very hilarious.
In fact, that is exactly the way that I look when I get on the dance floor.
No, I don't
today.
Believe it. Yeah, I do not believe
she's
it.
She's prettier, but that's pretty much the exact way that I dance.
Oh my gosh. Well, you know, and to be honest, I wasn't a born professional dancer. Dancing has changed my life, too. You know, just like it changes... everybody else's lives, but, you know, I used to be very anxious and very shy.
Really?
You know, there's been a lot of blocks and things that I've worked through dance.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the benefits to you personally, and then some of the benefits that others, you know, might realize as a result of gaining the confidence to get off the floor, get out of the bleachers, get out there onto the dance floor and enjoy themselves. So for you, what are some of the benefits then?
Well, you know, something I think people can relate to is being a perfectionist in the world.
Uh-huh.
You know, we strive for perfection and we wait for the moment when we get there and we never do, and we miss out on so much in life. And dancing is one of those things where, hey, you don't have to be perfect. You don't have to know all the right moves to have fun.
Right, because when you're dancing for fun, there's nobody with a scorecard.
Yeah, well, the thing is, and this is my angle, I mean, dancing is an outlet. Dancing is where you can just chill out and have fun, you know, and a lot of people don't necessarily see that. They think dancing and enjoying dance is being perfect out on the dance floor.
Right.
You know, so that's one thing. Another thing is confidence, what you were talking about, and a lot of us do have anxiety. You know,
sure.
Even moving in front of someone else is kind of scary.
Yeah, it is.
You know, extending your arm all the way, you know, and doing a weird hand gesture, that's also kind of weird. But hey, if you do it and you mean it, hey, it looks really cool.
Right. Now, you know, I come from the world, I shouldn't say come from, but I spend a lot of time in the speaking world. And one of the misconceptions in the speaking world is that it is probably, public speaking is probably the greatest fear that people have, even more so than death. But,
oh.
in some conversations recently, we have really kind of refined that to, it's not the fear of public speaking that really freaks people out, It's the fear of looking like an idiot in front mm-hmm. of other people. Mm-hmm. I mean, let's face it, we all know the English language, we all know how to speak and talk, but the fear is in looking like an idiot in front of other people. And in dance, like you say, you don't have to have perfect moves. You're not necessarily out there being scored, unless, like in your case, you have gotten to the point where you are a competitive dancer and you are willing to be scored on every little move that you make. Mm-hmm. But for us to get out there and have fun at our wedding, the first dance as husband and wife, to go out on date night, to go out to a club and enjoy one another's company and get out there on the dance floor, you know, we don't have to be perfect. And I think that's a very good point that you make.
Yeah, and you know, another thing, benefit of dance, is that it engages two lobes of the brain. And it's the only sport, aside from ping pong, that engages two lobes of the brain. So you can imagine, you know, the benefit of it. You know, you have to be practical. You kind of need to know what you're doing in coordination, but at the same time, creativity. What about what you just want to put out there?
So
you know?
Practicality and creativity.
Yeah.
I didn't think about that.
So, I mean, there are, I think, studies done. I have to look it up. But the neuroplasticity of the brain, you know, can be stretched.
Wow.
Through dance. And I've taught seniors the Argentine tango a while back.
Really?
At the senior center. And it's so amazing. You know, class starts off slow, but, you know, they get hooked and they get sharper. And they start dancing with each other, and it's so cute, you know.
Yeah.
They don't have the best posture. But, you know, some of them just have such immense patience and that they feel so good to dance with. And it doesn't even matter how old you are, you know, it's what's coming from inside.
Sure.
And so I've seen dance affect, you know, so many different people, and it's just so exciting.
Yeah, it is. So it's, you have said that dance is transformative as well. What do you mean when you say dance is transformative?
Oh, well, I suppose it's leaving behind things that are holding you back, you know, because through dance that you challenge yourself. You take risks. You put yourself out there, and it's the scariest thing, but you do it, and you do it well, or you liberate yourself from the fear. And all of a sudden, it gives you this adrenaline, these endorphins, and it's almost medicinal. It makes you naturally high.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is just awesome. I'm so excited. Now, you know, unfortunately, we only have a one-hour show here. We're going to come back again next week, of course, But I want to get through so many things today. I want to hear a little bit about the Peace Corps and the role that the Peace Corps played in your pursuit of your dreams.
Well, you know, I joined the Peace Corps because I wanted to give back.
Okay.
You know, and it gave me a lot of perspective because a lot of us here in this country don't realize, you know, the lifestyles led in other countries where people do have real deficits, where they can't pursue a dream. Are you kidding? They can't even pursue maybe an education beyond ninth grade because they have to work in the field or something.
So you served in?
I served in Ukraine in a little village called Pachayev.
Really?
Yeah, which is a country.
That's in the news today.
In the news.
But I mean, that certainly sounds like a kind of a third world country that maybe they don't have all the niceties and opportunities that we have.
Yeah,
here.
I mean, my best friend was a goat that lived with me.
Really?
But, you know, I lived on a dirt street. We didn't always have water. We didn't always, you know, have warmth or heat, whatever. But, you know, people connect with each other. People, you know, will have each other's backs. If something is not okay in someone's life, they'll come to the rescue. You know, they use each other. And I feel like I'm so blessed in this country to have the freedom to pursue my dream, that after the Peace Corps, I kind of like, what are you doing not doing what you love?
Yeah.
You know, you are so lucky to be in this country and, you know, you had an education, did that, you know, and you have a dream, and not doing that, you know, kind of gave me a reality check.
So it gave you a new perspective on the quality of life that's available to you in this country and all the opportunities that you truly have.
It's true. And the thing is, what I'm doing now is my giving back to this country. This is my service after the Peace Corps
That's awesome.
To my own country. And I see the deficit of you know, connection and the technology, you know, that gets in the way. And this is me coming to the rescue with dance.
That is awesome, and it's obviously something that you have in your heart, and it's something that you do well. You have a passion for, and I suspect that you never work a day in your life, do you? when you have this, you're just sharing your passion, it can't be considered work.
Yeah, well, when you believe in something, and you know, when you see how you help others.
Exactly. We have a lot more to talk about. We have to go to our halfway break here, but stick with us. We're going to be back with more Sophia and Sapphire and Do You Want to Dance right here on Vegas AllNet Radio. Awesome.
It's going well.
Awesome. Real well.
Sophia Konstantinovna, Sophia in Sapphire. How are you today?
Hi, Al.
Oh, you have some wonderful, wonderful stories. I never tire of hearing the story of you telling me about your best friend in the Ukraine was a goat.
Oh, yeah.
living in a village where the streets were paved with dirt.
Yeah,
and,
you know.
And really gives you a great appreciation for the opportunities and benefits that we have here in this country.
That's true.
That is just, that's an amazing story. I always like hearing that. I love hearing about the benefits of dance, how it's transformative, how it helps you to either reconnect or connect with your partner, and maybe an opportunity to regenerate some of that spark. And, you know, we've been talking a lot about dancing for the first dance of husband and wife. But you go beyond that, and you teach senior citizens how to dance, and you teach all sorts of people in all walks of life at various skill levels and interest levels. I know that you have a meetup group that you use to share kind of the beginning information, the beginning insights into what dance is all about. Tell us a little bit about that meetup group, where it meets and when it meets, and how they can find out more information.
Yeah, so the meetup group, the whole point of the meetup group is to kind of help locals just to try out what dancing is all about.
Okay.
Dip their toes into something that they might not necessarily know if that's what they want to do.
So,
you know?
Not necessarily committing to a long series of dance lessons and things, but just to come check it out.
It's a beginner's meetup. Yeah. Every month we do a different dance.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So do you have this just once a month, or do you meet weekly?
It's
or?
Every week.
Okay.
Yeah, it's at 6 p.m. at the Ritz venue.
Oh, the Ritz. I've heard about that.
Yeah. So it's very nice.
Yeah, very nice place. Now, we're not talking about the Ritz-Carlton. We're talking about the Ritz venue that's been, I think, in Las Vegas for about 10 years.
Yeah.
And it's primarily a wedding event.
It's a banquet hall.
Okay.
And it's very beautiful. And so the cool thing of having my meetup at a non-traditional, you know, dance studio is that this is what a typical night out might feel like.
Right.
Whether it's a wedding or a dance floor in a restaurant or something
because,
like that.
Because, I mean, who's going to go out dancing at a dance studio?
Yeah. So my meetup is called How to Dance in Real Life Situations.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's not called Learn Beginner This or That.
Right.
It's how to dance in real life situations. And what we do is, you know, I make sure everybody gets like a twirl under their belt. You know, maybe a,
really?
Yeah.
So I would learn a twirl.
Yeah. Learn a twirl, learn to dip, learn how to ask someone to dance. These are like the little things that you might not necessarily get at a dance
because
studio.
you don't want to see me dip. I'll tell you that right now. You do not want to see me dip.
Well, then you're perfect candidate for the meetup.
All right, so the meetup is every Monday night, is that right?
It's every Monday night at 6 p.m., and every month we do a different dance. This month is The Hustle.
The Hustle. I remember that from the 70s.
Oh,
is that what we're talking about,
that
The Hustle?
That is the one we're talking
but
about.
But I'm just going to go out on a limb here and guess that you probably don't use the music from the 70s. You've probably updated it a little bit.
Well, you know what I do is I play all sorts of music at the meetup, at the class.
Yeah.
Because one thing that kind of eases people into dancing is dancing to something familiar.
Sure.
So I take something from the 70s. I take something from the 80s. I take something from you know, current, because a lot of people are like, oh, that's an outdated dance. You can't dance that anymore. You
so
know?
Do you have an example of what you're doing right now?
I do.
Well, let's cue that up and let's play
okay.
that.
Okay.
This has got about a 16-second bed before he starts talking, okay, or singing.
Okay.
Let it ride for a second, okay?
The beginning. What keeps the planet spinning? The force from the beginning.
We're 30 seconds in it.
We've come too far to give up.
Bunch of the old disco stuff we used to dance to.
Yeah, exactly.
So let's raise the bar.
40 seconds into it. You let me know when you're ready to back it out.
Let's give her another 10 or 15 anyhow.
Okay, we'll take it in a minute into it. Okay. Yeah, he's going in the chorus right now.
Let's go through this chorus. After the chorus, then start to fade it.
That's it.
All right, so that's an example of the song that you're using
yeah,
this month.
Yeah, so,
huh?
You know, Hustle in general is a feel-good dance. It's associated with good times, good friends, and happy feelings. And there's like this thump beat, thump,
yeah.
thump, thump, thump. And so all you have to do is make sure you change your weight on every thump. That sounds kind of scary, but if you just stomp, think about it. Stomp,
yeah.
stomp, stomp, stomp.
And that's all there is to it.
Well, that's the first step.
That's the start, huh?
Yeah.
All right.
And so, you know, you find a song that you like. That's the most important, dancing to music you like.
Yeah.
You know, and so I do play a variety of different music at the meetup, and Hustle was actually a 1970s, originated
in
the 70s.
In fact, when that came on, sound operator Michael Fox here and I were having a little conversation. We used to dance to that in the 1970s.
That's right.
Yeah, and long before you were ever around, but that's okay.
Wow.
That's all right. But yeah, Mike and I, we were called dancing to that in the discos
oh, yeah?
back in the 70s.
So was your dancing feel good?
At the time, it really was, yeah.
Yeah, so what's cool about the Hustle is it could be really totally casual.
Sure.
I mean, for the guy, you just have to, you know, like I said, you know, stomp, just keep the beat. But the lady is the one that does the hard part. And it could be flashy, it could be dynamic, it could be powerful looking dance, but it also could be, hey, you want to turn? I know how to turn. You know, you don't necessarily have to move your feet in a fancy way to twirl a lady. So that's one cool thing about the Hustle.
Yeah, in fact, you know what? I want to play a little clip for you now, Sophia, of the Hustle. That Mike and I
nice.
Danced to from mid-1970s, Van McCoy.
Pretty good, ain't I, huh? Pretty good, huh?
Hey, we've done this together a time or two before, haven't
oh,
we?
Yeah. But it makes me want to go.
Where's your white jacket? Van McCoy doing the Hustle.
Very
1975.
Cool. Very cool.
So yeah, that brings back memories. You know, it's all this talk about it and watching it, listening to the music. It is inspiring.
Yeah, and to just to clear something up, there are different kinds of Hustle. You could do it easy, right? And then if you're more advanced, there's syncopation, which sounds a little daunting, but it's when you combine movements that are a little quicker
sure.
than the other. So
sure. instead of just 1, 2, 3,
right.
4,
so,
use like quarter note, eighth note, 16th
yeah,
note.
Yeah, so the one that I played with a thumb, that's the one I start off the beginners
because
with.
It's very simple.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Sure.
This one has a 1, right?
Yes.
And 1.
Exactly.
You know, that quicker action, but very cool. Thank you for playing that.
Yeah, absolutely. We thanks, Mike, for helping make that happen. Now, so what does it cost to come to your meetup group on Monday nights from 6 to 8 o'clock over at the Ritz?
So I invite everyone, and I do not require any sort of payment. But
really?
I do ask for love donations
oh, okay.
for my time.
All right.
You
well,
know,
that's only fair.
Well,
so.
Because, you know, what if you don't want to dance? And at that paying for a dance lesson when you don't even want to dance.
Yeah.
So this is just me giving you the opportunity. Hey, you want to check it out? Come. You don't even have to dance. You could watch.
Okay. All right, so come check it out, and if it's something that that makes sense, something that you want to get into, then, you know, come on, treat Sophia right and take care of her. Although there's not an admission charge, you have to buy a ticket or not,
right.
not a set fee. But if it moved you to the tune of $100 and you dropped $50 in the, in the hat, you're not going to complain about that, are you?
Yeah, and you know what? The thing is, the whole point of this meetup is to go out dancing once a month.
Uh-huh.
In real life situation, I pick a venue where they're probably going to be dancing or playing the music of the dance we learned.
Sure.
And we all go out in a group, okay, we all know each other, we become friends, and we actually dance in real life. What we've been learning all month.
Yeah, you gotta like
so
that.
So this is our dance field trip. Uh-huh. That's included.
Excellent. Now, I understand that once someone has, you know, made the decision, made the commitment that they want to take lessons and they want to perhaps get ready for that first dance as husband and wife, that you offer a 10-lesson challenge. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so that's actually giving you the opportunity to, and the time, to give yourself the chance and allow yourself to experience the fun of dance. Because honestly, nothing you do in the beginning necessarily feels right.
Sure.
You know, everything feels a little awkward. You need to put a little bit of time and effort at repetition. So what the 10-lesson dance challenge is we kind of come up with a plan. You know, maybe you pick a song that you want to dance to, and we come up with a little something, a little special something, so that by the end of the 10 lessons, you have something to show for all the work you put in.
Sure.
And along the way, you're encouraged to kind of show your progress and your dancing journey on social media.
Okay, well, I want to hear a little bit more about that. We have to go to our final break of the show, but stick with us. You're listening to Sophia and Sapphire and the Do You Want to Dance radio show on Vegas All Net Radio.
Okay, I'll listen to the...
It's Big Magic Al Jensen coming to you from the Do You Want to Dance show on Vegas All Net Radio. I'm sitting in the driver's seat today as the host, your host that will be running the show next week and forevermore is Sophia Konstantinovna, or Sophia in Sapphire. I just love saying your last name.
Thank you, Al.
Love saying your last name. I love your company name, Sophia in Sapphire. But tell me, what is Sophia in Sapphire?
So we are actually a one-stop shop for learning how to dance. We have meetups to set you up with go-to moves. We take you out dancing in the real world to use them. You know, we esteem tried and true teaching method. We break down the basics and making dance accessible for anyone. And through Meetup, we will be having group classes and parties complimentary. However, implementing small packages of private dance lessons are not a bad way to give justice to your dancing. So I would encourage and invite everyone to check out our perks and discounts on our website, and also follow us on social media to check out what we're all about.
Well,
and
tell us where we can follow you then. What are those addresses?
Okay.
And names and things like that?
Well, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. They're all the websites with a / Dance with Sophia.
Dance with Sophia.
S-O-P-H-I-A. That's right.
Okay.
So, for example, Facebook.com/ Dance with Sophia.
Okay.
Easy enough.
Now, let me ask you this question. You know, if I came out to a meetup and kind of just stood in the back and kind of watched and got a feel for it, and I thought, okay, I might want to do this, but not in front of all these other strangers that are at the meetup group, so I could set up a one-on-one or a two-on-one. I bring my wife, and so we could have kind of private lessons with you where I wouldn't, you know, embarrass myself in front of all these other people.
That's the whole point. I mean, the meetup is a place for you to get to know me. Do you like me?
Well, I can answer that question right now. Yes, of course.
Now.
I mean, anybody. I can't imagine anybody who has ever met you that doesn't like you. You are just an instantly likable, you know, kind of person. So,
what
I bet you don't have any trouble. If you were ever asking someone to dance, I bet nobody has ever turned you down, have they?
Well, maybe they did.
Maybe they did,
but for reasons we do not know about.
That's true.
You know, people are intimidated by professional dancers.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why, you know, a lot of people don't dance because they're like, oh, I'm not good enough to dance with her. you know, but that's not what it's about. I love it when somebody asks me to dance. I love that.
Yeah.
I don't care if they're good. Do they feel good? That's okay.
Yeah.
You know, do they know many moves? That doesn't matter. But the couple moves they do know, do they feel good?
Yeah. Okay.
I'd rather dance with that guy.
That's cool. All right. So tell us briefly about your professional dance partner, because he is going to be guest on next week's Do You Want to Dance show. Tell us who he is and a little bit about your professional experience with him.
Okay, so my professional dance partner is Eddie Getham, and we've been dancing together ever since I moved out here to Vegas, which is about for a half a year ago. And we compete in a division called Rhythm, which is Latin dancing, but American.
Very nice.
Right? He's also a fitness buff. He does yoga, Pilates, dancing. So he incorporates...
I hate him already.
all of the fitness aspects into being healthy. And
sure.
So leading a healthy lifestyle is really important, especially in this day and age. And I think he's going to have a lot of insight for us.
That's great. So he's going to be on the show next week, and we have some exciting things planned for future shows. We're going to have some people who are involved in the wedding industry, who are professional dancers, some who are beginner dancers, who have gone through some of your meetups and who have gone through some of your private dance lessons.
That's right.
They'll be sharing their experiences with our listeners, things like that. So I don't know about you, but I'm really excited for I'm really excited for more of the Do You Want to Dance radio show. So, before we go today, is there any shout-outs you want to give to anybody special out there?
Well, to you, Al. Thank you so much. Well, I enjoyed the interview.
You're so welcome. I'm glad to do it. So, it has been a wonderful time here on the first Do You Want to Dance show with Sophia Konstantinovna of Sophia and Sapphire. We just can't wait to do it again next week. So, thank you and say goodbye, everybody.
Thank you so much. Goodbye, everyone.
We did it! Very good. Very good, young lady. Very good.
Sorry, I was about 3 seconds early there.
No, that's all right.
Better early than late, I guess, huh?
Do you want to dance?